We wanted to do some tracks that were much more groove-based. That's when we brought on board Timbaland, and Justin Timberlake also came to help with those sessions.
It's been an amazing experience. Most of the songs have been written and recorded very, very quickly.
I think the first time was the best one.
So you get that first bit of inspiration on the record.
It was a real revelation working with producers that just understood the groove factor. And this really brought back the heart and the spirit of Duran Duran.
Down, chick down, out. Down, chick down, out. We halved that.
Down to holding. Yeah.
That's easy edits.
That's also one of the best bits.
There was 30 seconds.
We just had four bars of killer, melodic, sweet groove. Well, what happens if you straighten it up a little bit? We've got this amazing sample.
Yeah.
And then you just got to find a way of playing what you do against that sample.
I think my favourite part of this whole process is just been letting go, actually. We always want to be in the driving seat, and it's been really interesting to just let somebody else sit in the driving seat for a while. Just take us on a journey, like a musical journey.
They're really an extraordinary team between Justin, Timbaland and Nate.
And they have a very, very keen ear when it comes to rhythm.
They have a fantastic chemistry.
I've got a very keen ear when it comes to the harmonic structures of things.
Yeah, I've got it.
I see you over there. I don't want to stand and stare.
Keep that, let me show you one other thing.
It's as if the band, as if Duran Duran has been taken and has just been surrounded in chrome.
Duran was always that, really. We always went to the big cities. We always went to the people that are having hit records on the dance floor. And we've kind of come round to doing that again. And I think it kind of keeps you vital.
When we went to the studio, Justin and Timbaland had been working for a few hours in the afternoon preparing some beats and some ideas.
The first record we did together, Timbaland produced, and that was Night Runner.
This reminds me of Notorious, when the band first split and working with Nile Rodgers. You're nocturnal, only come out at night. And I'm learning all the ways you want to ride. I came in here, in this room, and started seeing something. Justin came running in. He said, "Simon, can you hold on? I've just heard something. I want to sing it." And he sang this very simple, very effective melody line, which I really, really liked. And then suddenly we had it all there, really.
Right into your nighttime world.
Right into my nighttime world.
Really, the only producer out there that we all liked was Timbaland.
And I'm certain I'll catch up to you one of these times, baby.
Justin is an enormous pleasure to work with.
What's it been like working with Mr. LeBron? Pure fucking hell. And he asked me a question, man.
And you steal my photographer. And then Timbaland came in and sat and he blah-blahed the middle bit of the song, which is the love is haunting. And we're going, oh yeah, you say, is that love is haunting? She wanted to go. That's what she told me. You know, we were trying to hear the words in the gobbledygook that he'd sung. And he's going, yeah, that's what I meant. Exactly.
Cannot.
No, but is the track skinny or is it fat is what I need to know.
Oh, it's fat.
Huh. I mean, I love Night Runner. For me, it's so instant. Because
But interesting story is how we met these guys. I mean, we first met Timbaland and Justin
at the MTV Awards in New York some years ago. We were there to give Justin a dance award.
So we called him up, and we did, and he came up on stage. And
just as we were coming off, we bumped into Timbaland, who was with Missy Elliott.
Said, yeah, it'd be nice to work one day, wouldn't it? Yeah. Cut to a year and a bit later, and it was the Brit Awards in London.
We talked about maybe collaborating, but you always do that with artists that you like, and then it usually doesn't happen.
That's good, that's great.
And then we had a big party afterwards in London, and he came and sat down with us, and I think, you know, we said we'd love to do something together. It's a real challenge every time we meet in a studio to begin a new project. It's incredibly, it's stressful. But it's also very exciting as well, because we all know how great the possibilities are.
And with Falling Down, it's a really beautiful, fragile song. I think it's certainly one of the best lyrics Simon wrote for a very long time.
And we took a car up to Manchester and had an amazing 24 hours with Justin, and just came up with possibly the best song on the album for me, I must say.
And it was so easy. Sometimes that's the mystery of making music and writing songs. It can just be natural and happens there, and then other times you can struggle for weeks and not get what you want.
This song is a tempo ballad. He wrote some very melancholic / inspirational / cryptic lyrics that are beautiful. I mean, if we're gonna make a pop record, let's make a proper pop record. Why has the sky turned gray? Hard to my face and cold on my shoulder. And why has my life gone astray? Scarred by disgrace, I know that it's over. This one is very Duran Duran.
We fight because it's very personal, because we all care about it very, very much.
It's quite an abrasive relationship, actually, between the band members.
It's a very elusive thing. It's I call it the group conscience. I mean, no one person has power over another.
It's like the House of Lords. Everything has to go through all the band members.
Like most democracies, it's a bit of a nightmare trying to deal with things in our band.
We're very sensitive to each other.
We've always had a lot of abrasive things going on between the band members.
You know, if one person feels something very strongly, we tend to listen to it.
Nick wants one thing, Simon has this lyrical idea that doesn't please John, but I like it.
The democracy of this band is something that we defend quite furiously. We just work through our shit as we go along, you know.
And then we'll go out for a drink together and we're fine.
By the time we get to finish an album, it always feels to me like, wow, there's a book in there. It's another massive chapter in the band's history. We made a record we all feel really good about.
We come into the studio, Nate had got something going, and Timbaland sits down, he starts playing a keyboard, and then John picked up a bass and he'd start playing along with it. Nick is quite sort of experimental. Roger's doing some extra rhythmic things. And I found that was a great way to write. A great example of that one, actually, Skin Divers, and that's exactly how that song got written.
Skin Divers is a really important song for me. That was the song out of the three songs we wrote in New York that had the most depth to it.
For Timbaland, what was exciting is that he'd never really produced a rock band before.
I'm not a band. It's just me and Nate. Now I know how to work with a band. I never know how to work with a band.
Walking in the skies, waiting for the fall. Meet me at the corner shop.
The track that developed had an instant energy to it.
Something you won't find in the West End pages with your Google dirty fingers. That's what I like about Skin Divers.
That, I thought, was you know, the song that best captured the sense of, you know, Timbaland meets Duran Duran. That's what it feels like when you come up for air. Think it when you come up
for air. You feel brand new when you come up for air. That one hit me instant. Instant, you hear me? Instant.
Going into the studio with Nate, he got the fact that we were a band.
He's got so many ideas, talent in bucket loads. He feels Duran. He has patience and he has real vision.
And he very much got the spirit of the band.
He's another person who just expresses himself with the sounds he makes. It's been a joy to work with him, actually.
Oh yeah, I'm in the booth. I'm gonna call you right back.
Well, John and I have always pretty much been at the front of the artwork with Duran Duran. I mean, obviously, Simon and Roger are very involved in that they have a say whether they like something or not, and when we choose an image, because there was a lot of images we mocked up for the cover. It wasn't just the one with the girl lying down. There's a lot of images of the four of them. Some of them are used in the booklet. And that was the most popular image, the one we always thought, you know, was striking and was right for it. But John and I tend to, if we can agree on something and find a direction, we're pretty confident about it. It's been like that since the very, very beginning, and I love collaborating with John on things like this. I mean, on tour programs and on merchandise and particularly album covers. So this is actually, believe it or not, the first time in 20-something years that we've been putting out albums that we have done it all ourselves. We had this fantastic title, Red Carpet Massacre, and it's so visual. John and I spent many hours discussing what to do with the album artwork. We thought of commissioning a great modern artist to paint something, which we hadn't done for a long time. We thought of licensing possibly a photograph, maybe a Guy Baudin photograph, something like that. Then we thought about commissioning a photographer to do something sort of modern and edgy. And we went going backwards and forwards for a while, and suddenly, because the album took so long, we were actually running out of time. And I happened to be staying in France with some friends. They all had very beautiful girlfriends. So I thought, right, we should photograph these girls. And I discussed it with John. We said, well, let's see what we get. So I went on a hunt to find some red carpet, which is actually not as scarce as you may think, particularly if you're in Cannes. It seems to be available all year round. And so there I was, my credit card, buying some red carpet, and I've managed to pick up a few other accessories, and I shot four Russian girls, Irina, Natasha, Anna, and Marsha, all of whom looked stunning. And we played around with a lot of different images, but I wanted something with a little humor in it. I wouldn't like anyone to think that the title is serious in any way. So in the end, we ended up laying Anna down on the red carpet and some very nice spike-heeled shoes, just threatening her a little. And then we thought, for safety reasons, we'd blank out the identity of Anna, who, of course, is inside the book if you really want to know what she looks like. And that was the story. And I sent the computer discs with all the photos over to John and Patty. Patty Palazzo, who does a lot of our artwork for us. And said, OK, let's see what we can do with this. And John had this fantastic idea of sort of making the logos tape, sort of like police tape almost, Red Carpet Massacre, and also Duran Duran's Red Carpet Massacre, which I rather like. It's different. I haven't heard that. And since we're going to be performing it on Broadway, I think Duran Duran's Red Carpet Massacre just has more appeal than Duran Duran, Red Carpet Massacre. That was really the story, and they sent back some images, and Patty made the picture. She sort of televisionized it, put some lines through it, so it looked more like a news story coming through. And the colors were pretty pumped up anyway. And so it became Red Carpet Massacre.
We try to control as much of our related
medias as we can. I think because we understand it more than anybody else. The album cover, the photography for which Nick actually took, and he and I had been talking about particular kinds of photography that we kind of liked the direction of. Guy Bourdin, we'd been talking about Helmut Newton a little bit. We wanted humor in it, and we wanted a little bit of a little black humor in it, really. But we also wanted sex and glamour. You know, we were trying all sorts of things, and actually, I called Nick one day and said, why don't you just do it? I knew he could do it. Nick's a terrific photographer. And why don't you just do it? He's like, well, that's great, because I happen to be in the south of France in this big house with these four beautiful Russian girls, and, you know, typical. And I'll see what I can do. I'll rent some carpet, and we couldn't do any of this if we didn't have Patty Palazzo working in Los Angeles, who's just, you know, terrifically talented graphic designer that I've done a lot of work with over the years. She does a lot of work for Juicy Couture, and she's been doing more and more work for the band. She really has worked some magic, and again, you know, we start getting a concept and things start falling in place, and it's kind of exciting. You know, we're in a position where we can do it ourselves. It's just an area that we've always been interested in, particularly Nick and I. And I've spent a lot of time in the graphic arts sort of area over the years, and he spent a lot of time on his photography. So, you know, with this album, we were able to bring it all together.
And Nick took the photos, sent them over to me, and I went through them. It was a matter of going through them, cropping them, blowing out the contrast, put a technique on it that gave it so that we wanted them to look sort of like video still, something happening right in the moment. You know, if we were first talking about whether it's a hand, an elbow, you know, a look in the face, and the photo that we settled on was just, yeah, everybody saw it, and immediately it was, that's it. It's so striking.
What a great job you did on that album cover. Thanks,
you
honey.
Too.
Of them. One, two, three. And they were all keeping this perfect distance. All keeping this perfect distance from each other. They were like, they're all slowly moving around, like they're in this weird dance, you know? Very cool. Yes. Morning mixture, porridge with chili sauce and soy sauce and rice wine vinegar. It's yummy. I've been here since 6. It's now 10 to 7 in the morning. We're in Los Angeles at the Santa Maria Luisa Hospital, and we're about to shoot the video for Falling Down. And it's just full of pretty girls, this place is. It's gonna make it quite difficult for us.
It's now 7 a.m. We're in a psychiatric hospital. I'm sure we're not gonna be doing anything for like 6 hours, but they'd just like to get you here for like 7 a.m.
We are about ready to roll. We're about 5 minutes away from meeting Simon for the first shot. It involves him and one of our models named Monica. And she is actually one of our hero girls, our lead girl. So it should be a pretty interesting shot. First shot of the day, kind of getting Simon warmed up with performance.
Oh, goodness.
Oh, my goodness.
Goodness me. I'm a doctor in the hospital. I'm one of the characters that carries you through the narrative. I think I'm in charge of the hospital. Then I think I'm in charge of everything. That's just me. I have met my patients this morning, some of them, but I haven't quite established a doctor-patient relationship yet.
Roll playback, please. Roll your camera.
I just think that it should be a combination of
singing to camera, but also singing down. And
I like detail. I love detail. I like to have a story. You know what I mean?
I think it's a great idea, and I think it's kind of just unraveled itself as we've gone along. The title, Red Carpet Massacre, initially we just liked the sound of the phrase. Some started to write the lyrics around it, and then we came up with the Falling Down song, which is all about somebody going through a really bad time in their life. Then that kind of inspired the video. This kind of social commentary on what's happening with celebrity culture right now, with the victims, the supermodels that end up in rehab, the actresses that end up in prison, and just the victims of the whole, you know, red carpet kind of culture that we're in. She's great, she's really got the look. She's got it down pat, for sure. And actually, I didn't say, I've been dying to dress up as a doctor and say, hello, ding dong.
Yeah, we're like models in rehab.
Violent and strung out and kind of out of it and talking to walls and unresponsive.
I think there's a mystery around rehab. And I mean, without doubt, they are potentially holy places, mystical places. It doesn't work for everybody, but when it does work, you know, then they're great temples in a way. And I hesitate to say it was an idea worth exploiting, but oops, I've said it. I think it'll only be a matter of months before we're probably seeing some pilot TV show called Rehab. It seems to be an important part of our society getting itself together at the moment. My experiences with rehab were quite possibly the most important 30 days of my life. But then, even if it's complete, that's it.
Here comes back.
When I was walking around.
You have to stand up.
All I'm wondering at the moment is which floor was shock treatment, and whether anyone actually had a lobotomy here. Is this, by far and away, the most exciting modelling task that you've ever been given?
Definitely. I'm sitting in a wheelchair with so many drugs in my system that I'm basically a zombie.
My role is to look at purple-blue clouds.
What time did you arrive here today?
A bit before 6. 6 a.m.
6 a.m. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What time did you get here?
Well, you know, my...
So I'm wearing Dolce & Gabbana Couture, and I think that I'm fabulous. And everything that I do makes sense in my head. Why did the luck run
dry?
Well, Simon? He's the rock doc.
I think the great thing actually is the casting has been incredible. I mean, the girls are just, from where I've seen it, perfect. All the girls are very interesting looking, very weird looking. I mean, it's not just like your standard set of runway models. They've all got something very interesting about them.
You know, we're going for that been out all night look. I tried to get some sleep. It's going to be a long day.
It seemed to be that we were sort of surrounded by celebrity meltdown everywhere, on television, in magazines, in newspapers. Even on the radio, you turn it on, you hear about who's done this and what's happened in Hollywood and who's gone into rehab and who's shaved their head. And the song is really about somebody who just loses a grip on their life.
So it's a disused hospital, which I'm told is haunted, so it's kind of creepy. It's a great location. It's really cool, but it's creepy.
Yeah, I need a stethoscope. Yeah.
Darn it.
It's quite good, isn't it? Looks great.
It's a very beautiful looking video. We chose Anthony Mandler to direct it based on some of the other stuff we'd seen, which I thought was really stunning. He's got a fashion background as well. He used to shoot stills.
heroin chic.
No, hospital chic.
I would describe it as couture, and then I would describe my look as torn up.
A little bit more, I think couture outfit, sexy nurse. It's traditional, yes. Never leave home without it.
So whose outfit do you think's the best of all the girls?
Oh. What outfit do I like best? I kind of like that the girl that you just filmed sleeping, which is kind of cool.
We don't want to wake her up.
The big lacy number.
But you two got the best shoes by far.
Mine's unzippered right now.
That's definitely.
Ding dong, Roger. Ding dong.
Okay, go behind the screen and put your clothes next to mine.
When we all decided to go for this idea, quite honestly, I could have not been in it at all. It was really only when Anthony put forward the proposal for the band performance being a particular way that made sense to me and appealed to me, did I really want to go for a performance at all.
Once was a man who consumed his place and time. He thought nothing could touch him. Ow! But here and now it's a different story.
I was expecting at all. I turned around and thought it'd be the Broad Girls again, and they were having a party this time. And it was just so different, amazing.
It's now 10 o'clock at night. And I think we have about 3 or 4 hours to go, so.
When did we have this much fun on a video set? I mean, it doesn't get any better than this. But it's just these beautiful girls, so beautifully dressed, having so much fun.
I have a lovely view, actually, I have to say. I think it's shaping up quite nicely. And Dom has played his first part in the video.
It's been a good day. Just look around you.
Today's been interesting. My neck contraption kind of affected my mood a little bit. But besides that, pretty good.
It's now 12:15 a.m. I've been here for 18 hours. Actually, I think it's bath time.
Lifeguard.
Being a huge fan of the band from when I was a kid, it was an honor to work with them, at the chance to work with them. I love the song. Thank you, sir.
I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Product placement.
No, at all.
This is being sensible at the end of the shoot. Have a sip of that.
Is this for me?
Yes, yeah, certainly is. Not all of it. Well, actually, you know, it is all of it.
It's actually my favorite part of the shoot today.
Yeah, really?
Thank you. Such a pleasure.
I've enjoyed this so much.
So
much. Oh, God.
With your Google dirty fingers, it's a skin. Yeah.
what it feels like when you come up for air. Feel it when you come up for air. You feel brand new when you come up for air. Feel it when you come up for air. That's what it feels like when you come up for air. Feel it when you come up for air. You feel brand new when you come up for air. Feel it when you come up for air.
Wipe us off the face of the human race. Whichever way you look, it's indisposed or disgraced. Fighting on the shore, the oi polloi one more. Howling bloody murder, but it's nothing, just a murmur in your skin.
Ah.
On offer for lunch today, we have grilled kangaroo on a coriander falafel with lemon tahini sauce and green pepper relish. Can you take us?
For like a documentary look. I never like posing, so something natural, something angry, I love it. Escape from me.
Escape.
That's fun. Oh. Yeah, that's great. I like it. Yeah, and just go through. Yes. Yeah. Okay, two steps, let's go. Okay, coming in, really. Expecting to be like a very rock and roll. There you go.
Thank you.
Very nice.
Very energetic Japanese photographer whose name is Mari Sarai. She's great.
More sexy, baby?
More sexy? Yes.
I'm sexy and being soft.
There you go. Because this is like a psychiatric environment. Yeah, I don't know.
So it's all over?
Yes. Hypothetically, in a way. Does it ever end?
Depends how you behave.
I think you can count on me misbehaving.
I think we did well today.
I think we did too. White always works the best. What do you say that we take this footage and we just...
don't ever show them.
And we just, it'll be like our brilliant film that nobody ever sees.
I like that.
It's like the Kubrick movie that nobody ever saw. I'm so used to directing, it's so hard for me to be directed.
We got enough for about 7 minutes, do
you think? I think we have enough for about 70 minutes. And most importantly, you guys have contributed to this great movie that I'm making slowly, video by video. It's gonna come out, it's gonna have everybody I've ever worked in. It's gonna be this great narrative. I'm about two videos away from finishing the story. It's genius though, and the broad-based appeal in the audience of it's hundreds and hundreds of millions if you count all the radio play and all that stuff.
Because all those girls are so fresh after 16, 18 hours?
I think we're at 19 or 20 now. I could go another 4 or 5, no problem. Thank you, sir.
I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
It's quite sort of experimental, you know, for us. Things are very bony and spare. And it happened very quickly as well. I mean, the whole thing really has come together since in between the end of September 2006 and May 2007. So it's actually, will be the fastest album we've ever made. God, there's so many records that we've made. And you hear one thing, but when I hear it, I hear where it started, which was, you know, a completely different song. And that song was just as good. It's just that we worked it and worked it and worked it, and it ended up changing. And I feel sorry for, I feel bad about those songs that went missing. You know, we'll never get them back. We'll never find them. This one, we've actually got those original ideas on the record. I think that's very important. Lyrically, this album has got some depth to it. I mean, there are some very, very important issues, important to me and to the band. And to get to that, you do have to dig, and to dig, you do experience a sort of a certain amount of pain, and it's insecurity, because, like I said, you're always wondering if what you've got inside you is good enough.
I think realistically, we've always tried to make records that sound very different to each other. And in the case of Red Carpet Massacre, that's certainly what happened. The thing with Duran Duran is we sometimes will make rock music, sometimes we'll make dance music, sometimes we'll make more ambient music, but we're always interested in the broad picture of what creative artists are doing. When we all arrived in New York for the studio sessions with Timbaland, there was a great air of anticipation. We had no idea exactly how it was going to work, and a lot of people had said to us, well, you know, you're going to have to be very patient with the way they work. They like to start with a groove track first. But honestly, when we got in the room and we started working, it just all poured out. Don Brown played the guitar with us, actually on all the tracks on the album, and you know, we'd only played live shows with him. We hadn't actually been into the studio until this record. So we had fun working on different aspects of it, because he's very good at playing funk. I think Night Runner is a great example of that. But also he can play that sort of almost Hendrix-like guitar that is on Falling Down.
And for the first time in many years, we've let somebody come in from outside of the band. Probably the last time we did that was with Nile Rodgers and Bernard Edwards. And I think it's been a great experience for us to go back to that way of making records. So we suggested to Nate, do you want to come and work on the album? And, you know, he was very excited about it. And we just thought we'd try with two or three tracks with him. But it was so successful, he went on to complete the rest of the album with us. The second phase of the writing was very urban-based. Has made a huge difference, actually. I think it's one thing going and shutting yourself away in a house somewhere, but actually coming to a city like New York rubs off on the album. We've always been a band that's had an association with the dance floor. I mean, a lot of our first records were made, you know, with 12-inch records back in the early 80s. You know, the most important thing for us was that they were being played in the clubs. And so that's always been a sensibility within the band. So luckily, you know, we were open-minded enough to take people like Timbaland and Nate on board and, you know, really work with them.
It wasn't too dissimilar from the way we always worked. Usually, Nick will fire off a loop or a sequencer, and then, you know, it's like the musician's job to sort of dance around it and find some music in it. It's got a lot of soul and rhythm and purpose to it. I mean, every band has its own story. We don't write individually, but we certainly, you know, we take this particular songs that each of us will take under our wing, and, you know, there are songs that I feel very strongly for, that Nick does, that Simon does, you know. And, you know, I didn't feel, I mean, I don't know, I just felt entirely confident. The Valley is, it's an old school Duran cerebral journey song. And as I'm listening to it, I'm seeing the fairy lights all sort of moving, and I'm in the center of the stage, and it's all about me. Nate's production of The Valley, that to me, I, when I heard that, I knew we got a great record. It's the theme song of the record, I think. It's the show opener. So that to me is a very important song. Red Carpet Massacre is a very important song. It's the yin to, or the yang to The Valley. It's a very short song. Very short, almost a Green Day kind of energy on the chorus. You know, and then that phrase that Simon came up with, which was just killer.